Some people might wonder what the professor is always doing in front of the coffee machine. Is he coffee addicted or is he actually doing research? In my case, I can happily announce that I'm doing research. My name is Frank Lipnizki and I'm doing research on membrane filtration processes. You might wonder what a membrane is. Generally, a membrane is like such a coffee filter. The membrane retains some of the components and allows others to pass through. In case of the coffee filter retains the coffee powder and then the coffee goes nicely into my cup. The main difference between a coffee filter and a membrane is that the coffee filter is doing separation on a macro scale, while such a membrane is doing separation on a micro down to nano scale. You might never heard about membranes before, but membranes are part of our daily life and they are used in the water, food and biotech industry, as well as in the pulp and paper industry and biorefineries. Membranes can filter the water, juice, milk, beer and wine you drink, concentrate enzymes used in your washing powder, or purify the antibiotics you take when you are sick. Membranes are a fascinating field of research, and currently the membrane team at Lund University is working with applications strongly related to the 17 global sustainability goals. We will not save the world, but we hope to contribute a little. Unfortunately, my 2 minutes are now over, and I will hand over to my colleagues explaining their exciting research, while I finally enjoy a cup of coffee. Cheers.
Hi, my name is Mariona, and I am working with membranes in biorefineries. Membranes can have many applications within biorefineries. Biorefineries are industries which use different processes to convert renewable biomass, for example wood and agricultural waste, into different products. These products can be biofuels, power or chemicals that can replace the ones produced from fossil resources. Replacing the fossil resources with renewable biomass can reduce greenhouse gas emissions. There are many different kinds of biomass that can be used as a source for a biorefinery. One biomass source that we're working with in the membrane group is a byproduct from the pulping industry called black liquor. In the pulping industry, wood is converted into pulp, which can be then used to make paper. With membranes, the different components of black liquor can be separated and turned into valuable products. In our current project, we want to separate the lignin in the black liquor. Lignin is a component found in wood and can be used to produce biofuels, for example, for cars and potentially jet fuels.
Hi, my name is Astrid, and I'm also working with membranes in biorefineries. Did you know that bacteria can be used to produce fuels from biomass? Another project which we're working on at the moment is obtaining biobutanol, produced by a bacteria called Clostridium. Butanol is a chemical which is widely used in industry, and it also has potential as a biofuel. Today, butanol is mostly produced from fossil resources, but it can also be produced by bacteria. This process was actually invented 100 years ago by the first president of Israel, Chaim Weizmann, who was also a chemist. This bacteria can convert waste materials from, for example, the forest or the agricultural industry into butanol. Where does membranes come into the picture? Well, when the bacteria have produced the butanol has to be separated from the rest of the products that the bacteria produces simultaneously. The membranes could separate the butanol from the rest of these products in an energy-efficient and sustainable way.
Hi, my name is Simon. Another application for membranes is wastewater treatment. So everything that we flush down the toilet ends up in the wastewater, and therefore we need to treat it. One way of doing this is to filter the water through a membrane, which stops bigger substances from going through. And if the membrane's pores are small enough, we can even separate bacteria, viruses, or small chemicals such as pharmaceutical residues in the wastewater. At the same time as we make clean water, We can use the separated dirty stuff from the wastewater to create biogas. To sustainably treat wastewater with membranes, we must make sure that the membranes are with the right settings, which is one thing that we're investigating in this lab. So, what about the stormwater treatment?
Ah, this is my part. Hi, my name is Mina Takil. Have you ever wondered why do we use expensive drinking water for gardening, toilet flushing, or washing our car? We get plenty of storm water every year. This is the water that originated from rain, including snow and ice melt. This water can be collected, treated, and reused. And this is called stormwater harvesting. In this way, we will reduce our dependence on drinking water supply. So how to treat the stormwater to make it safe for reuse? Our research is working to develop, test, and optimize a membrane concept for stormwater harvesting with focus on microplastics and pollutants control. We will collect the stormwater from ponds in Lund City. This water then goes through membrane filtration and treatment to make it free from bacteria and other pollutants. In this way, it can be reused in, for example, flushing, gardening, or washing our cars. This research is an important step of the global sustainable development goal, clean water and sanitation. If we can understand what we might be able to do here to improve stormwater quality for non-drinking purposes, it will help to make our city more sustainable for all of us and for the coming generations.
We have already shown you that membranes have a wide range of applications and benefits in industry. However, there's a major challenge that prevents the adoption of membrane technology on an even larger scale: membrane fouling. Membrane fouling is basically the blocking of a membrane during the filtration. This is a problem because it lowers the production capacity, changes the separation performance, and shortens the membrane lifetime. But there's help: regularly membrane cleaning. However, membrane cleaning requires cleaning chemicals, consumes high quality of drinking water, and generates huge amounts of wastewater. And of course, during the cleaning, the membranes cannot be used for the production. Therefore, it is very important to know why membrane fouling occurs in order to prevent it, to improve the cleaning protocol and the overall separation process. To gain knowledge on the fundamental level of these challenges, we are using many different analytical techniques in cooperation with other departments in and outside the Chemical Center in Lund. Here, two examples. The first example is an image of a cross-section of a membrane by scanning electron microscopy and energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. The green yellowish part on the top is ascribed to magnesium and represents a 5 micrometer thick fouling layer, roughly a tenth of a human hair, that was built up during the month in operation. The red bluish part shows the membrane. The second example is a scan of a membrane with X-ray microtomography, a technique that is similar to CT done in the hospital when you have a broken knee. We will perform this analysis in a synchrotron facility such as MAX4 to determine the porosity of a membrane before and after fouling and cleaning on the nanometer level. Overall, our research helps to find solutions for challenging separation tasks and improves existing membrane processes, hereby reducing the energy demand of production processes in many fields and supporting the transition into a sustainable society.